call this workshop to order. This is our first in a series of budget workshops. This is not an official meeting. However, we do have an agenda, and we will adhere to the agenda as closely as possible. However, it's much more informal, and if breaks are needed other than times they are scheduled, we will take them. There is no public comment at this segment. If you need to get up and move outside the room to have a discussion or conversation, please do so. Other than that, I'll ask for a motion to adopt the agenda.
So moved.
A second. Motion to adopt the agenda. All in favor say aye.
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 We have an agenda adopted. At this time, I'm going to turn the meeting over to Mr. Manager. Start your presentations.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As a point of clarification, Madam Chair, this is actually, it is an official meeting of the Board of Commissioners, but it is not a regular meeting of
it's
the Board.
It's not a regular meeting. Thank you.
But it is an official meeting of the Board. It is a workshop of the Board. The meeting will be taped and recorded. We will have all of the presentations for today published on our Onslow County website. We're not sure how long the day is going to go, Madam Chair. It's up to the presenters and questions and the will of the Board. We've scheduled from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. That's actually a fairly long meeting to have live on G10, so we are taping, and we can make copies available certainly to the Board through DVDs or thumb drives and to anyone else that might want them as well as a matter of public record. In addition, how today would be going, how staff has prepared for it to go, is there will be lots of movement in the room today. And that's okay because it's a Board workshop. And we needed to have it in this room, number one, so we would have enough room, and also so we can utilize the camera system that's in place in the building as well. Normally we would have our Board workshops in room 111, which is across the hall, but it's smaller with no cameras. Here the room is set up a little bit differently than it's been set up in the past. That's so we can get camera angles on the Board and on the presenters, and also so the public and everyone can see all the screens that we have. In terms of how we're set up to present to you, Commissioners, we've got 12 different items before we hit Commissioner's direction to staff, and most of those items, actually all of them, are going to be presentations to the Board. So we've got basically 12 different PowerPoint presentations. In the back, our production room will be queuing up the PowerPoints and the presentations from one to the next. And so as we move from one to the next, I'll be giving a brief intro into what we would be doing. Most of the presentations today are at a very, for lack of a better term, high altitude. All of the hard work on the budget is going to happen between now and June 1. June 1 is when the commissioners, by statute, receive the budget which you will be considering. So on June 1, that's when your budget workshops actually begin. I've got a timeline here in just a moment. So in June, the commissioners consider the budgets, and then by July 1, you would adopt the budget for the following fiscal year. What is today then? And we'll get this in a second. Maybe I should go ahead and start the presentation. But today is when we receive additional direction from the Board on your expectations for a budget for you to go over. Now, in the past, what we've done is we have received direction from the Board either in regular meetings or workshops. And it's been, I guess you might say, quieter. In a lot of places, it's called the sausage-making time. When we're going through the budget, this is raw data today. You're going to be getting a lot of raw data, raw numbers, raw requests. And there are a lot of requests. So we're going to on the front end this year, in a very public fashion, share with you all the requests and get information from you on how to move forward. Since we're at a very high level with the presentations, if you have specific questions, we've asked that our department heads be present. And department heads, I would ask that if you've been asked a question, please leave your seat. come forward to one of the two microphones across from me. In just a couple minutes after her first presentation, Ms. Roberts will come over and join me, and Harry will join the audience. So those tables are for any of you to use in answering questions from the board. So with that having been said, Madam Chair, I'm about to use my mouse to change. Go ahead and hit the next one, Ms. Roberts. So as we begin, the first presentation is mine. This is a budget process overview. Where have we been and where are we going? November 2015 budget forms were first available to the departments, and this includes both personnel forms and the capital improvement program forms. What capital requests, construction requests are necessary, what personnel requests are necessary, new positions, reclassifications. January 2016, the budget was initialized in the computer system. Departments were able to start keying in a lot of stuff then. March 2016, nonprofits and outside agency requests were due. A point here, there was an article in the Jacksonville Daily News yesterday, and I only would like to make one clarifying point on the entire article, and that was at the very end, it quoted me as saying that more needs to be added to the budget. Specifically, what that meant was we were inputting more outside agency requests over the weekend. So department requests were in, but there were additional outside, some lagging outside agency requests that we did input into the budget. So department requests are in. I was not saying that our budget needs to be bigger. I was saying the data is not complete. It would be complete by this morning, April 11th, 2016. So department requests are in. Today we're on the blue line, April 11th, 2016, Board of Commissioner guidance on budget creation. As in the past, you've given me guidance. And in fact, the big three, I recently made a speech about the big three, public education, public safety, and consolidated human services. We have a big three because that's been the guidance of the Board of Commissioners. You've placed your emphasis on public education, public safety, and well, mandatorily, legally, you have to do consolidated human services. You don't have a lot of choice there. But because of that past guidance, that's how our budget is developed over time. The statutory deadline for the budget to the board is June 1. I anticipate giving the board the budget on June 1. On June 6th, we would request that at the regularly scheduled meeting of the board, we have a budget presentation, and at that board meeting, request that you set the public hearing. Then from June 14th through 17th, there's the first series of board budget workshops. We've reserved time then, and that's when the Board of Commissioners, as every year, you get down into the nitty-gritty, the individual line items of the budget. June 20th is the budget public hearing. Statutorily, you are unable to adopt a budget until the public hearing happens, and after the public hearing, at any time, you're able to adopt the budget. So, in some years, the commissioners have adopted the budget the night following the public hearing. If you've not heard anything else that's compelling for you to change your mind, you've adopted the budget. In other years, following the public hearing, the commissioners have gone back into budget workshops. And you have between June 20 and June 30 to have additional workshops or a special meeting for board adoption. You can either call a special meeting or you can recess the June 20th meeting for a later time, a specific place and time in which you could consider the budget then.
Jeff, then could July, I clarify yes, something, ma'am. Please? When you present the budget to us on June 6th, that is not the budget. That's just what you're presenting to us. It's still subject to changes.
Oh, yes, ma'am. Okay. The managers, city and county managers, we're required to give you a manager-recommended balanced budget.
Okay.
So today, at the start of the process, you do not have balanced requests and revenues. You have what's going to be presented today is all of the revenues we believe that we have coming in, and then every request from everybody. And by the time I give it to you on June 1, the statute doesn't kick in on you today. The statute kicks in on me between now and June 1, and our entire budget team, and it's not, by the way, it's not just me sitting in a room. We've got every department head involved and a budget team of 8 or 10 people. And we will work between now and June 1 to give you a balanced budget that, number one, where we have revenues and expenditures that balance, where we're still in a responsible financial position, and number two, that we have met to the extent possible the desires of the Board of Commissioners as you expressed to us today or between now and June 1.
And that budget will not entail the tourism expenditures?
No, ma'am. The budget that I present to you is, well, in the past, what you've done the last couple of years, you've set aside a pot of money. Mm-hmm. All revenues and expenditures have to balance, including tourism. So what you've done for tourism grant requests, because they are grants, you're making tourism grants to agencies that want tourism grants. In the past, you've set aside a pot of money, and then following the adoption of the budget, you take more time to say, out of that $200,000, we will give this fishing tournament $5,000 and this festival $2,000 or whatever. But you have set aside the pot from which you will make grants.
Okay.
July 1, the new fiscal year begins. Specifically, the Board of Commissioners, you do not have to adopt a budget by July 1. Onslow County, to my knowledge, has never gone past July 1, because to go past July 1, you will have to adopt a continuing resolution, a continuing budget resolution, which is difficult. We will continue spending this year's money, and at some point in time, like you see played out at the state or the federal government level, things get kind of ugly. So we've always, always been able to adopt by July 1. Next slide, please. Today's objectives, just two objectives. First of all, we want to present information to the board and the public. As I mentioned kind of during the housekeeping comments, this process is a little new, but it's also the same. Every year, the commissioners have given me direction in what your expectations have been on the budget. Do you expect to have a tax increase? Do you not expect to have a tax increase? Where do you want the emphasis to be made? What specifically do you want to do, or what specifically do you not want to do? But this year, we do want to show everyone the massive number of requests that are coming in, and to make the process even more transparent than it has been in the past. And at the end of the day, after everything, all the information you're given, staff would ask for two things. We want to receive board direction on your budget goals. Dr. Doyle is going to help me at the end of the day. There are two pieces of paper over there, and the top one says streamlining, and the other one says invest. If during the day you hear a presentation, as an example, we'll have a presentation on one-time capital purchases over $100,000. And in those, and I'm just picking one at random, but in those, there's a request for two new ambulances. If you during the day say, you know, hold on, I think that more than anything else right now, we need to get those two new ambulances, then if you know that, just so that we have captured it as we go along through the day, we would place that on the sheet that says invest. That's kind of the brainstorming session. So through the day, if there's something that really hits you for invest or streamline, we'll try to capture that. And then at the end of the day, we would continue the brainstorming session. Now, you've all participated in a dot exercise before, where you're placing dots on a sheet of paper based on what you believe is most important. At the end of the day, we would give you 5 green dots and 5 red dots. And after we have listed all of the brainstorming issues, after we brainstormed all the investment and the streamlining, just as a prioritization exercise, we would ask for you to vote with your dots. We definitely want to do this, and more green dots go there. We definitely think we need to streamline that. More red dots go there, and staff will take that just as a prioritization exercise as we move forward into the budget. So that's just a facilitative tool that we would use. And of course, if the Board of Commissioners have any specific direction throughout the day, we'll be making notes on that, and we'll move forward with the budget like it is, based on your direction. Some notable notes. The data is current as of today. Data will change between now and June 1. So what do I mean by that? Well, at this point in the process, even every year between now and June 1, we spend a lot of time making sure there's not been a keying error, that we don't have an extra zero somewhere, that we haven't got a typo. And that's very important in the budget. So we will continuously try to make sure that we haven't found a mistake. There may be some additional information we get, for instance, on sales tax, and that's a bullet farther down the page there. There will be additional sales tax data forthcoming from the state. So every month that passes, we will get another month's worth of reported sales tax data. And sales tax, as Ms. Roberts will share with you, is a very important revenue stream for us. So today in April, we have some sales tax data. By the time June 1 comes around, we'll have more. And that helps us do a trend line, basically, on our sales tax revenues. This is the start of budget work for the budget team. Individual departments have been working. And we've also been working compiling everything. But now, over these next couple of months, we're heavy into it. Unfortunately, we have a star player that's been out, Mr. David McColl, our chief financial officer. He has not been present with us the last week or so. His mother passed away, and he had to go back to his home state, and he is helping with his family right now. We expect him back this week, but I would like to commend Ms. Roberts and the staff of finance, and also our internal auditor, Ms. Melissa Moore Freeman, for helping us with what you've done. So thank you, and our thoughts go to David. When he comes back, he'll be reinserted into the process. Expenditures shown today represent every request from everywhere. Because you see it on the screen, it is not an endorsement from staff that we believe it is necessary or fundable. There is one in particular. There is a single request for $10 million that came from an outside agency. But we are giving you the raw data. So today you are seeing, and the public will see, every request from everywhere. So what do those requests look like? As presented today, there will be 94 separate requests. By that I mean, well, one might be a department, the health department. If you have departments broken into divisions, because not only does each department have a budget, but each division in each department has a budget. And I'm staring at the sheriff in the front row. Sheriff has the sheriff's office. Sheriff has the detention center. You've got other budgets as well, narcotics division and stuff like that. So if you then break that out, there are actually 3,000 individual lines of data. So we go through 3,000 individual lines. We do run a line item budget. With 3,000 individual lines, if we printed that, the budget would be over 400 pages long. And the detail that we have, and I'll use the county administration budget, for example. Under county administration, so we have a department supply line. And the department supply line, the request amount is $3,000. And if you take a look at the individual transactions, this is the detail that we can go into. Bubble mailers, 5 units, $6.83, total $34.15. Cardstock for programs and invitations, 15 units, $14.99 per unit, $224.85, et cetera, et cetera. Building to, you know, that total. If the commissioners want to get that detail today, Melissa has on her computer and other computers, we can get into that. But in the meantime, we're mainly presenting at the department level today. Jessica. So that concludes an overview of where we're at and the availability of detail. Commissioners, the next item is the presentation on projected revenues. We wanted to begin with telling you this is how much money we think we'll have. And with your permission, Madam Chair, I'll turn it over to Jessica.
Let's hear from Jessica.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Hey.
Mr. Smith and myself will be presenting the information on revenue projections. To begin with, we wanted to display a chart reflecting the major revenue sources. They include the ad valorem property taxes, sales tax, and restricted intergovernmental revenues. Combined, those total 88% of the county's projected revenues for the general fund. Ad valorem taxes are based on the assessed value of personal property and real property. The rate is set by the Board of Commissioners and applied uniformly throughout the county. Sales tax is a tax on the sale of tangible goods and some services and service contracts. The state authorizes the counties to levy optional sales tax, and then a referendum is required by the voters. Restricted intergovernmental revenues are normally in the form of grants. Use of funds tends to be restricted. Many are dispersed on a reimbursement basis, which requires the county to spend funds and be reimbursed. In cases where funds are received ahead of time, some funds may be required to be returned, and other funds we may be required to recognize a fund balance that would be restricted at that point. Other revenues make up 12% of the projected revenues you see here, as well as 12% of the current adopted budget. Those include revenues from sales and services, other taxes and licenses, register of deed stamps and privilege licenses, permits and fees, transfers from other funds and component units, as well as intergovernmental, miscellaneous, and revenues from sales of capital assets and investment earnings. That was just a broad overview. Now we'll go into more detail of the different major revenue sources. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Ms. Roberts. Good morning, Commissioners. First, I'd like to start out with our property tax revenue estimate. And to begin to arrive at that estimate, we want to take a look at our current tax base. And the chart in front of you here shows our breakdown of assessed value by property type and general categories. This year, we're estimating our real estate tax base to be $11.588 billion, personal property $548 million, and public service company property $284 million. I have subtotaled these because these constitute what are known as annual taxes. These are billed and collected by the local tax office. In addition to those, which subtotal $12.420 billion, we also have registered motor vehicles. And as in 2013, registered motor vehicle taxes began being collected through the combined tax and vehicle registration process by Division of Motor Vehicles. Our office is still heavily involved with the assessment of those processing those records prior to the invitations to renew being mailed out. But those or constitute $1.138 billion, bringing our total tax base estimate for this year to $13,588,700,000. Just want to talk briefly about the assessment process. On the registered motor vehicles, the assessment is initially done by the Department of Revenue on the state level. Basically, they assign values to the vehicles, which are then sent out to the counties, and our office has a responsibility to review those and assign values to any properties that come through or any vehicle records that come through that do not have a value on them. Usually that involves things like campers or utility trailers or horse trailers or motorhomes, those types of things. The public service companies, these are properties that are assessed on the state level. They are properties such as power companies, cable companies, telephones, airlines, bus lines, those types of properties. So the state basically does the assessment on those, and they report to the county. Each county in September would get a list of all the public service company properties that are located in our county and the assigned values. Personal property is property such as manufactured homes, boats and motors, airplanes, and business personal property, which includes furniture and fixtures, computer equipment, machinery equipment, that type of things. Those are assessed annually by the county assessor and primarily based on listings that are submitted by personal property owners. And finally, real property, which consists of land and buildings. Currently, they're assessed every 4 years by the county assessor here in Onslow County. The state requires each county to do a countywide reappraisal at least every 8 years, but does give the counties the opportunity to conduct on a more frequent basis, and our current resolution has us on a four-year cycle. Going a little bit more in depth on real property assessment, our last countywide reappraisal was effective as of January 1st of 2014. And during the reevaluation year, the primary objective is to take a snapshot of the market at that point in time. And those values basically stay in place until the next countywide reappraisal is done. at a snapshot and a point in time, you're looking at primarily data that occurred in the market prior to the revaluation date, as the assessors or the appraisers use those values to value individual properties based on the property characteristics in each neighborhood. During the non-reappraisal year, our tax base typically increases a little bit, and that's primarily as a result of new construction that comes online. As building permits are issued, our appraisers go out and physically list and measure all those improvements. And based on the schedule of values that was adopted during the last reevaluation, the assessments are determined. Includes new construction on residential properties as well as commercial property, land splits when property is subdivided. Generally, that would trigger an increase in or a change in the value. And new subdivisions come online during non-reappraisal years, which are assessed also based on the last schedule of values. However, changes in the market value are not recognized until the next reappraisal is conducted. As a matter of fact, the statutes specifically prohibit tax officers from changing values based on changes in economics in between reappraisal years. When we look at our assessed value history, we'll see that we have typically grown over a period of time. Going back to the 2006 reappraisal, our tax base was around $10.5 billion. In 2010, it had grown to $12.3 billion. Up until 2013, it was at around $13.8, and then the 2014 reappraisal went into effect, which is we saw a decrease in our tax base, primarily as a result of reduction in residential values at that time, and our tax base dropped to $13.1 billion. Since that time, we have experienced relatively modest growth compared to the years prior to the 2014 reappraisal, and our current estimate has gone from 13.4 was our actual last year to about 13.558 for this year. When we look at a breakdown of different property types and how much of the total tax base those properties make up, we see that real estate is by far the largest component of that, which is represented by the red part of the graph, and that's around 85.5%. Registered motor vehicles are the next largest part, around 8.5%. Followed by personal property at 4% and public service company property at 2%. So when we're looking at determining our estimated revenue from property taxes, the valuation is an important component, but also we have to look at the tax rate in order to determine how much of that projected income we'll be able to budget in the current year or in the upcoming year. So first of all, we'll look at our collections percentage history. This is a 10-year history. And you can see it's run around 96% and has recently begun to increase. Part of the contribution of that is the combined tag and tax system. Registered motor vehicles are no longer part of this percentage. This is only for annual taxes that are billed by the county assessor's office. And last year, our number was 97.51%. When we look at how our budgeted tax revenues compare to what we've actually collected, the blue bar represents the budgeted number, and the red bar is actually collected. And of course, fiscal year 16 still has 3 months remaining to go, so it's slightly below the budgeted number, but historically it's been right at or just slightly above, with one exception. Last year was just slightly below. So we've looked at the assessed value, and now we need to look at our collection percentage and determine how much of the calculated taxes we'll be able to budget. The state requires that the collection percentage used for budget purposes be no more than the percentage that you're expected for the previous fiscal year. Last year, fiscal year ending June of 2015, our collection percentage was 97.51%. Our initial projection has it at 97%, which is a conservative number. So if we basically do the math, on the previous slide I had subtotaled our annual taxes, which was the real estate, personal property, and public service companies, came out to $12.4 billion times the current year tax rate of 67.5 cents per hundred, and then taking 97% of that number yields $81,324,000. The vehicle taxes, since they're billed under the combined registration process.
Cliff, yes, sir. Does that vehicle tax include the cars on the base?
Cars that are registered and reside on base are not taxable. If the situs location of the vehicle is like someone that lives in base housing, it is not taxable. But the estimated assessed value this year was 1.138, and using the same formula, 67.5 cents, and basically it's 100% collection on those. We're estimating $7,681,000. for a total revenue for current, for next year's current taxes of $89,006,000. Now, in addition to the what we bill each year based on current year value and the anticipated collection percentage, historically, you have also collected taxes that were not paid as part of that. On the collection percentage, remember, we looked at 97.5, so that left 2.5% that was uncollected during that year. But typically, we see around $2.7 million come in that people didn't pay before the end of the fiscal year, so it may be for a 2014 or 2013 bill. But we always add in the amount of prior year taxes and interest that we anticipate collecting also, and when that's added to the 89 million, we come up with a total tax revenue projection this year of $91,773,550. And compared to last year, that's an increase of $633,000. And of course, as I stated previously, this assumes that there'll be no—
I have one question.
Now. Yes, ma'am.
With the prior year taxes and interest being 2.7 million, has that been pretty standard in the past years? It's been about that much in the back delinquent taxes.
Yes,
collection.
Ma'am, that's correct. Oh,
okay. Harry, I've got a question.
Yes,
also.
Sir.
I don't know if you may have it, but maybe on a future slide, but what percentage of the real estate tax is classified as commercial versus residential?
I don't remember the exact percentage. It seems like residential makes up about 75%, and commercial would be the next largest segment. But I don't know exactly. I'll be glad to get it and get back to you with that number. I don't know right offhand.
Reason I was asking is we had several people that come to our meeting one time, and they were concerned about the commercial revaluation rate, and it seemed that the commercial properties were pretty much hit harder, a lot harder than even some of the residential properties that went up. And of course, we had some that went down on account of the housing market.
But, right.
There was a lot of people concerned about the commercial revaluation numbers that came about.
Yes, sir. I don't think I have that in a slide, but I'll be glad to get back to you with those numbers.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Harry, let me jump in, being we're asking questions right now. The public utilities, did we not see a decline in that revenue a couple years ago, or has it been holding fairly steady?
I don't have the historical numbers. It seems like they're pretty flat. Usually there's a very modest increase from year to year, but it seems like a couple of years ago there was a slight decrease.
Yeah.
And I think last year it actually increased a little bit.
Yeah. But that's one of those variables that we have no control
that's
over.
That's correct.
And I believe in answer of Jack's question, it was about 18%, was it not, for the commercial? I know.
That sounds about right, as far as the total percentage, because then the vacant properties and properties that may have some type of auxiliary improvement would make up the remaining portion of that. But that sounds about right, around 15 to 18%.
And over the past few years, I know we've taken a hit on personal property that was on the base that we no longer could tax, and we lost the revenue, like Mr. Jarman said, off of not only the active military, but the spouses' vehicles are with the change in that. And I believe that was something like $300,000 that hit us last year or year before last.
Well, the military spouse relief came in, it's actually been a little bit longer than that when that law went into effect. But
yeah.
We also have had an increase, and I didn't bring those numbers with me, but from the property tax relief programs, there's
exactly.
Increases every year with the number of folks that are qualifying for those programs, particularly disabled veterans.
Mm-hmm.
And this year we also had a new piece of legislation that was passed last year that exempts builder's inventory.
Mm-hmm.
And the impact on that has been far less than what it could have been. It's, I think the last number I looked at was around $6.7 million in value, which is pretty small in the big picture.
Well, the reason I bring this up, because so many people, and I know they say it to probably all of us, with all the building going on, how in the world can there be a revenue shortfall? But if you look at the data, the building has only gone to offset several of these revenue reductions, I'll call them, that we've had to endure over the past few years. So the mere fact that we are holding steady or somewhat steady is a contributing factor to that growth, but it does not show that actual the boom in building is a boom in revenue.
That's true. And looking at the, we're referring back to the graph we had on total assessed value on the years prior to the 2014 reappraisal. If we look back at the average percentage growth in the tax base, it was running 3.5% or so. Mm-hmm. And the past couple of years, it's been like 2%, and this year is 1.1%.
And that makes it difficult when we sit here and we try to project future growth. And I will like to just compliment staff because they've always used very conservative numbers in our projections. So I think that we've been very conservative in our projections with so many variables that we have no control over. Thank you, Harry.
Thank you. I just got, I think, one more slide to show, and because I mentioned that these revenue estimates were based on our current tax rate of 67 cents per $100, and just information, as of last fiscal year, there were 49 counties in North Carolina that had a higher tax rate than Onslow County, and 33 of those are located in the eastern part of our state, which are our neighbors, as this map depicts. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Ms. Roberts.
The next major revenue source that is going to be presented is sales tax. I meant to mention earlier in the presentation, as was mentioned by Mr. Smith and Chairman Eichner, the county does tend to budget on a conservative, in a conservative manner, where our revenues tend to be very conservative in nature and our expenditures seem to be higher. With that in mind, the projections you're seeing, we've applied that conservative manner. Sales tax revenues, the current sales tax rate in the county is 2.25%. Article 39 is a 1 cent sales tax. It is distributed based on point of sale. It is the purest form of local sales and use tax. Wherever the sale occurs, the county receives the revenue from that sale. There are no restrictions on this. There are no restrictions on how the sales tax is spent. Article 40 is a 0.5 cent sales tax. It is distributed based on the county's population in relation to the state population total. It is restricted. 30% of the revenues from this must be spent for school capital. Article 42 was previously distributed based upon a county's population. Effective November 2009, collections are distributed on a point of sale basis. These funds are also restricted in how they can be spent. 60% of the revenues are required to be spent on school capital. Article 46 is a 0.25 cent sales tax. The state allowed counties to levy this tax a few years back, and a referendum was put out by the county and the voters voted for it. It is based on point of sale. All of the revenues generated from this do come to the county for sales within the county. As a stipulation of voters voting for this sales tax, 50% is required to be spent for public safety and 50% for education. The distribution method of the sales tax within the county is currently the ad valorem method, which bases the distribution to the municipalities and the county based on the levies.
Ms. Roberts, just as a point of clarification, if you'd turn back one, please. When you were talking about the different articles, and the restricted funds in those articles, and the method, you said method of distribution several times. I just want to make the point that the method of distribution you were first referring to is the method of distribution from the state of North Carolina to all 100 counties in the state,
yes.
Whether it was point of sale or based on county population. And then there's a separate issue of once the sales tax money is received by the county, how it is further distributed among the county and the municipalities. So I just wanted to make sure that we were clear on the first part about the point of distribution is from the state to the counties.
Thank you, Mr. Manager.
And could I just ask for clarification? When you say point of sale, Onslow County is considered one point. We also get sales tax from other counties that would not be point of sale. Is that not correct?
Point of sale method means that if a sale occurs in Onslow County, we receive 100% of the revenue generated.
Mm-hmm.
The population distribution is the distribution method where the state receives a pot of money from all counties and distributes it based on the population. So it is entirely possible that a portion of another county's, what was collected in another county, is distributed to a different county.
Okay. So point of sale is that is collected anywhere in Onslow County, and the the population is of all of North Carolina.
Yes, Chairman.
Okay.
Madam Chair, as one point on that, now Senator Brown had actually introduced a bill that would have said that if Onslow County residents went to New Hanover County or Greenville, or there are a lot of, can I say, Harnett County went to Wake County to shop, they earn their money in Wake County or Harnett County, rather, or they earn their money in Onslow County and they spend it somewhere else, and some of that money should go back to their homes.
Mm-hmm.
But as that bill failed in the General Assembly, we actually would have gained substantially, probably if we'd been able to go under that method. But right now, it's just population statewide versus the 100 counties.
Well, we have people that come from out of county. We have people come from Jones and Duplin and Wake to shop here also.
Next, we'll get into the projections and what the projections for sales tax were based on. Current year sales tax collection is displayed as a chart. This chart is from the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. As is displayed, the change in collections dipped in the fall but came back in the winter and fell again in February. When January sales tax was collected is when we see the dip. This was not anticipated. There is an expectation of sales tax to be higher through the holidays and then for it to drop. But this drop was not forecasted. And for that reason, there's a prediction of slower growth that may be due to a number of factors. And for that reason, the sales tax projections as displayed are very conservative. As is displayed on this chart, the total projection for the fiscal year is $35.6 million, which is approximately $2 million less than the current year. Year-to-date sales tax revenue is in line with current year budget. However, projections for next year are less than the current year. And this is back to the conservative nature of our estimates. We do not anticipate growth at this point with that. We do stipulate that we only have 6 months worth of sales tax data as of today. As more months come in, we will be able to more accurately project sales tax for next year. So this figure could increase or decrease.
Can we go back to the slide before this one? I was looking at January 16, and it looks like January 2016 is really way above from the other projection, from the other months. course, I know February dropped down some, but what was the reason for the spike in January, do you know?
Sales tax is collected in the following month. So what you're seeing displayed for January is for December sales, which would include those holiday sales. And that's a dip is normally expected after that month, but this much of a drop was not anticipated.
Do we have information on February of 2015 compared to February 2016 collections?
I do not have that with me right now. On the next slide, we do have the entire year's worth of collection data.
Just trying to compare February 2015 to February 2016 and see what that
yes, would Commissioner, look like. I can get that information for you after.
Okay.
So these are the projections as well as some historical data on sales tax collections.
I have one question.
Yes, Commissioner.
Which of these specific articles refers to what public safety gets, you stated?
That is Article 46. On the chart, it is the orange bar. As mentioned, the county is conservative on its estimates, and due to an assortment of data that is available currently, these are the current projections, and they may be adjusted based on additional data as it is received. The next major revenue source is restricted intergovernmental. These are the grants. Revenues represent federal and state funds that are received for the operation of specific programs. The use of the funds is limited to a specific purpose or function. These funds are mainly in the human services functions. Projections are based on data from the state. Based on this data, projected funding levels are less than the current year. It is approximately $1.1 million. The reductions in funding appear to be for child care and child support enforcement revenues. These reductions are applied in both revenues and expenditures. So the expenditures are reduced by the same amount for next year, the expenditure requests. They do make up the bulk of the difference on what is being displayed on this chart. It's similar to sales tax. These estimates for these funds are provided by the state. And as we get further into the budget process, these figures may change. And the way the county historically balances the budget is by appropriating fund balance. On this chart, you'll see that the county has historically prepared conservative budgets where revenue projections are low and expenditure estimates are high. This is evident based on the chart displayed. In the chart, the blue column represents fund balance appropriated, and the red columns represent actual fund balance used. Current projections do not include appropriated fund balance. Fund balance is the county's savings account, and it grows when revenues exceed expenditures. Fund balance at the end of 2015 was approximately $51.5 million. Based on our current estimates, we anticipate increasing fund balance by $500,000. Based on this estimate, the county could appropriate $500,000 more than the current year for next year, and without changing the county's current fund balance position. Appropriation beyond this amount would require additional staff review.
Jessica, let's explain this just a little bit. Because our funding and our revenue sources do not all come in at the exact same time, some are staggered as to when they are paid, when we receive. So when we adopt a budget, we allocate a certain level of fund balance. At the end of the year, when all of those outstanding revenues and outstanding expenditures are exact numbers and not estimated numbers is where we get the actual amount of fund balance spent. So in this slide, you're showing us that we have, over the years, actually at the end of the day, when all the numbers are actual hard, fast numbers and are in, that we have spent less and less fund balance as the graph shows. Is that correct?
Yes, Commissioner.
Okay. Thank you.
Ms. Roberts, one other thing I'd like to point out here. This is not a unique position to Onslow County. Mm-hmm. If you look at any city or any county in the state, I believe you would be hard-pressed to find a city or a county or a town that does not use some portion of fund balance, especially counties, because municipalities do not have the same responsibilities as counties. They don't have social services with federal disbursements, and they certainly don't have some of the other things that we have to deal with. So I don't want anyone, a member of the public, to look at this and say that Onslow County is unique in using fund balance. In the 22 years I've worked in Onslow County, the county has done this for 22 years, and so has other counties. Ms. Melissa Moore Freeman, before coming to us as internal auditor, was the chief financial officer of Jones County. This has been practiced in Jones County as well in others. So I just want to make sure that no member of the public believe that we were unique in this practice.
And I'm hoping that in your future slides here, you're going to discuss a little bit more in detail our fund balance and our levels.
Do you have any specific questions about that? Because this was actually the last of the fund balance.
Okay. The specific questions that I want answered is the state requires us to maintain an 8% fund balance. That's a requirement for all counties throughout North Carolina. However, we sit on the coast, and we're subject to hurricanes coming through and causing quite a bit of devastation. What is our current fund balance level? How low can we go, considering our location and the potential for a hazard? Now, I know a few years back, this board decided to take precautions against disasters, especially since there's like a 72-hour waiting period for FEMA to come in, and we want to make sure our citizens are covered at the time that they need to be covered. And we took $5 million out of fund balance and made a disaster ready fund out of it. So we've got money to spend in the first hours. So how close to the 8% do we dare get? Because if we are using fund balance to balance our budget, there's got to be a drop dead line that we say we won't go any closer than that.
Currently, Commissioner, I believe the 8% would be $11 million.
Okay. So what percent? I know in previous years, we had discussed a 25% fund balance to be our ultimate goal in achieving a fund balance. I know Mr. Jarman and I sat on Onwassa, we've got a 98% fund balance there. So the state requiring the counties to have an 8%, that may be good for some counties, but for us, we need to be, we need to monitor ourselves and put restrictions on ourselves much higher than the 8%. So what is our current fund balance?
Our current fund balance is $51.5 million.
Which would be what percent? Yeah.
That is roughly 25% of all expenditures.
Okay.
What was that percentage? I didn't.
25%.
Ms. Roberts, there's restricted and unrestricted.
Yes.
As well. Are you including the unrestricted and restricted fund balance numbers?
This is all inclusive.
Yeah. Okay.
So $51 million is not $51 million that the county has at its discretion.
Exactly.
$51 million includes all funds and all fund balances. So for instance, there's a health department fund balance, there's a solid waste fund balance, there's a general fund balance, and there's restricted and unrestricted in each one.
Yes, Mr. Manager. The $51 million is truly general fund balance. It does not include the capital reserve fund balance. It's in a separate fund. And it does not include the disaster contingency fund balance. This is strictly general fund. And the 25%, the $51 million, when I said 25%, that is in comparison to the requested expenditures that are being presented today.
Okay. Okay.
And also, I have one other question, and that is for the public's information. God forbid, if we were to ever get below 8%, what are the repercussions?
I believe we would have a visit from the state.
Yeah.
And the North Carolina.
I just want the public to be aware.
State would come in and tax us.
And take.
Set our tax rate.
And we don't want that to happen ever.
No, and you know, there have been times in the history, if I'm not incorrect, that we got a nasty letter saying, you're getting close, you need to do something about it.
1990 got one.
That's right.
And we don't ever want another one.
Uh-uh.
Actually, I think that is correct. In 1990, Mr. Alvin Barrett told me the stories. That predates me, for the record. But I think Desert Storm was happening at that point in time.
Right.
And there was a whole lot of deployment from Onslow County. As we've talked about sales tax numbers quite a bit, in addition to property tax, sales tax is something we really depend on. If a majority of the county deploys and you don't have Marines here, and at that time, I understand that the families went away as well. So we lost a lot of sales tax, and that was unexpected during the year, and the county's fund balance fell dangerously low. We were able to recover, the state never stepped in. And the state agency that comes in is called the Local Government Commission.
Mm-hmm.
One of the reasons that North Carolina has such a strong financial rating is because we have the Local Government Commission. We're one of the best-run states in America in terms of how we carefully monitor our debt limits. And every debt that's issued in Onslow County has to go through the Local Government Commission that does a complete review of our finances to make sure that we have the capacity to pay the debt. And also, if on an operational basis, year to year, we fell below, it is they that would come in and would basically take over the financial profile of the county and make sure that we're solvent.
And I think since this is April 11th, I will hearken back to April 16th, just a few years ago, when we had a tornado that came through our county and did some devastation. And because you say, well, there's 72 hours that you can put things in motion when you know a hurricane is coming, you can declare those things that need to be declared in order to get government agencies fallen into their procedure. But when you've got a tornado that comes through and devastates a part of our county like it did on April 16th about 4 years ago, we were able, because we have a disaster ready fund, to go ahead and implement cleanup and implement the services that those citizens needed at that time. But that is why it's imperative that we have a fund like that we set aside and say this is for those circumstances that are beyond our control, and we will always be ready to do what our citizens need. So the fund balance, we talk about restrictive and unrestrictive, and perhaps just for general knowledge, being that we're got such a nice audience group here today, you can explain a little bit more in detail what restrictive fund balance and unrestricted is as far as commitment to debt service or that would fall into restrictive fund balance? Is that what you would, how you would explain that, Jessica?
Well, Madam Chairman, we pay the debt annually. It is one of the items we are required to budget, and of course we pay it. So it doesn't, as far as general fund and the 51 million, there's not a designated fund balance for debt. The capital reserve fund does include that fund balance.
Okay.
The other, the 51 million is comprised of restricted and unrestricted, designated, undesignated, committed, so on and so forth. The restricted fund balance basically results from grants that are received and not spent completely. Or they may result from other forms of revenue that are received for a specific purpose and not spent completely. Unrestricted, again, tends to be the sales and services revenues received for sales or services of, throughout various departments. Occupancy tax is one that is a restricted fund balance because it is for a specific purpose. The investment and economic development funds that we have are for a restricted purpose. And those are the funds we withdrew from the Eastern Carolina Council of Governments a few years back.
Okay. It and would be very helpful to get what is on the, what fund balance is that we can do something with. Not that that we can't do anything with.
So the unrestricted, do you have it broken down to a percentage that is unrestricted?
As of June 30th of last year, the unrestricted was 11.1 million. Further review with consultation with Mr. McColl is required for me to provide any more updates on those figures because we have to evaluate what grants have been received that fall into that restricted fund balance information.
Now, when we talk, we're not talking in that 11%, and when we're talking about debt service, we have a separate fund balance or a separate capital improvement plan that is outside of this structure, is it not?
Yes,
is,
Chairman.
Is it not its own entity?
Yes, Chairman.
Okay. So the amount of building, the amount of improvements that we've been able to do in this county over the past several years is because of a separate and entirely other funding. And yes, I know we do, in 2009, we did take two pennies to seed that fund and to generate the reoccurring debt service that needs to be taken care of. But that is separate into itself out of this.
Yes, Madam Chair.
Okay. And just lastly, I know you probably feel like I'm grilling you, but just lastly, when you spoke in your first slide about other revenues and you spoke of fees from the Register of Deed and different sources of revenue that we come in, we don't take, that money goes straight back into the general fund. At any point in time, do we take those funds and say, okay, you're bringing in $2 million and your budget is $1.5 million. Do we ever compare what the request for funding is compared to what the revenue is being generated?
On an individual basis, that does occur to some extent. Some revenue sources, though, are to fund county business. Mm-hmm. So some of them, while it's looked at, it's not necessarily it doesn't determine the level of approved expenses.
What exactly I'm going to probably be getting into later today is requests for, and as Mr. Hudson had mentioned this morning, two ambulances. I know that we get revenue from ambulance calls. So at some point in time, we need to know, are we generating enough revenue from that service that we're providing in order to expand that service? And that'll probably be a question that Norm is going to be asked later on. But that was where I was going with that. So.
Yes, Madam Chair.
Thank you.
And Madam Chair, I have one other, and this is really a comment. And Mr. Hudson, correct me if I'm wrong. Since we're in this financial portion of the agenda and we're starting, and that is simply, one, John Locke Foundation recognizes us as being a very transparent community county. Is that not correct?
Yes, ma'am. We have an A in transparency from John Locke.
And then secondly, AA rating from Standard & Poor's? Okay, which looks and appears and is that we have a very good financial structure and a very solvent, financially sound county. Am I not correct?
Yes, ma'am. In fact, our financial advisors that help us with all of our borrowings, they're in the room. They'll be making a presentation later today, Mr. Doug and Mr. Andrew Carter. And they'll be talking specifically about our bond ratings from Standard & Poor's and Moody's. We're in a good financial position. And I believe that we are there for a couple of reasons. Number one, we do, when we look at our revenues, we budget our revenues conservatively. We try to be realistic in our expenditures. We don't go all wild in expenditures and overestimate. We try to be realistic, though. If we know gas prices are going up, we try to account for that. It is much better to account for that on the front end in July than in September, October, November to go, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? And we also have strategies in place. We have a funding formula with the Board of Education so that we know what to expect with them. And we have a long-range capital program that we're following. And part of what Ms. Roberts has been talking about is the Capital Reserve Fund. So that Capital Reserve Fund, which was started in 2009, which Mr. Carter and Mr. Carter will get into a little bit later on, that specifically is taking care of projects like this building or the courthouse or the other things that we're doing. But yes, we try to be as conservative as possible. I think we have one last point. We have a heritage of being very conservative, especially with our finance officers. Mr. Alvin Barrett and every department head that served with Mr. Barrett will understand. Mr. Barrett, he treated every penny of the public dollar like it was coming out of his own back pocket. And that's what we ought to do. And Mr. McCole and Ms. Roberts trained under Mr. Barrett. And Mr. McCole, thankfully, is also like that as some good CPAs on our side.
As it reminds me of, you know, an analogy, when you're home, you've got a budget and you want a good credit rating. And sometimes there are some sacrifices that need to be made in order to manage your credit rating, getting to the level in the 800s, if you will. And there are times that you put and you set aside savings for certain visions that you have in your family in order to operate and get some of those things that the family has come together to want to have in their possession. So it reminds me as we sit here, it's that type of an analogy where, you know, there's money set aside. You've got these silos of operating budgets, and then you've got these expenditures. And it's the same type of mindset, but you add a few more zeros to the process. And everyone wants great credit rating. That is something that you strive for. So it's that same kind of analogy, but like I said, put some millions to it. I guess that's apropos.
Yes, ma'am. And one other thing that's different about governmental accounting, we don't control how much money comes to us,
right,
for the large part in terms of intergovernmental revenues. Now, certainly the commissioners set the property tax rate. You don't control how much holiday shopping people will do in the community. What people spend for holiday shopping drives a sales tax, and that's a major revenue stream. The only thing you have control over is a tax rate. You do not control the values of property. As Mr. Smith talked about earlier, we have appraisers that appraise based on current market value to the extent humanly possible. But you do control the property tax. In terms of the slide that's on the screen right now, in terms of fund balance and our use of fund balance, in 2012, you'll see that a portion of fund balance was used. In 2013, and it fluctuates, but in this year, 2016, we are not anticipating that we actually would have to use the $13 million of fund balance that we appropriated. And that is in part for other reasons beyond what Mr. Roberts said. We have lapped salary. So in other words, not every position is filled by a living, warm body every single day of the year in every department. And when you have 1,250 employees and some percentage of vacancies through the year, then that's money that doesn't get spent. And we do not just turn around and take, you know, the lapped salary that we call it and buy everything that we can. That's how we're able to not spend every cent. So in reference to how much fund balance we would have available for next year, in all honesty, we need Mr. McColl to come back, and we need to have a few days sitting down with him and Ms. Roberts and our financial advisors and crunching some more numbers. But I think that Ms. Roberts' statement that if we appropriated the same amount of fund balance that we did this year with the additional of the roughly $500,000 or so, $600,000 that we believe that we would add to the fund balance, then that is safe. But the bottom line, Madam Chair, of your question is how much additional fund balance must we use to balance the budget? I do not think that we will have an absolutely hard and fast number today, because we just have to do some more number crunching between now and June 1.
The next few slides display what the projected revenues are in comparison to the current year's adopted budget. As is displayed, we expect the ad valorem taxes to increase, roughly $600,000, sales tax to be less by $1.5 million, restricted intergovernmental less by $1.3 million, and then some minor increases in sales and services and transfers from other funds. Permits and fees are projecting a slight decrease, as well as in miscellaneous revenue and investment earnings. The appropriated fund balance that you see on the screen is appropriation of restricted fund balance for specific programs. No undesignated fund balance has been appropriated yet for this in these projections. Two departments that haven't been mentioned yet are solid waste and the airport. These two are enterprise funds. Enterprise funds are funds that are run like businesses, and their operating revenues fund their operating expenditures. They tend to hold their own and do well year after year. We look forward to them doing well next year. Revenues are projected to increase for both by solid waste, roughly $800,000, and the airport by $200,000.
And these are standalone revenue sources, correct?
Yes, Commissioner. These are not included in the general fund figures that have been presented. So in total, based on the current projections, is there an increase or decrease in general fund revenues in comparison to the current year's adopted budget? There's roughly a decrease of $1.1 million. Are there any questions?
No. So we're not starting out the day with the best news, but we do believe that this is accurate based on a very conservative forecast of our revenues.
And as was stated, the more data will become available and hopefully the projections for sales tax in the next year will show a positive note, and maybe we can bump that up some more.
But we should note that we have received sales tax guidance from the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, and the it's called the sales tax advice. And the sales tax advice that we received this week was that statewide we're seeing some trends in sales tax downward, that people are being more conservative. In 2016, following the holiday bump, that people are spending more conservatively now. I don't, and oftentimes national you know, things are happening nationally have an effect on consumer confidence, and consumer confidence drives spending, and spending drives our sales tax. So whether it's the presidential election or other things happening or unemployment rates, which actually North Carolina is pretty good compared to some other places in America, we are seeing some advice that, sales tax should be budgeted very conservatively.
I got a question for Harry and Ms. Roberts. We have had a lot of announcements about ribbon cuttings and new businesses opening up all last year. And most of all those businesses were retail or sales or service. And do you know what percentage of growth we've had as far as from the year before?
The overall assessment number was up about 1.1%, but specific to those types of properties, I do not know offhand.
And I find the projection of the, is this mostly the sales taxes where we're getting the projection from for the decrease in revenue?
Back up, Jessica. Ms. Roberts, please. Right there.
So sales tax is where we're getting the project. I mean, that's a projection, though, I'm assuming still. With the amount of retail that's come online since last year, it would seem that sales tax would be up. And does this number here have the projections of the
amount of people
service tax that was just enacted, where we pay tax on service now? You know, there.
Tax on services.
That's one reason we were conservative. Is one because, you know, we did have new businesses open up, and the sales tax data received in February indicated that there was no growth. There was actually kind of a decline. That's why we're being conservative. The sales tax legislation that opened up certain services being subject to sales tax, data for that will not actually be known until, I believe, July, because it was effective March 1st. So with the timing of when it's effective and when the state receives it and when the county receives it, there's a delay. So as those figures come in, though, we will be reviewing that sales tax projection.
I had asked that question a month or so ago from Mr. McColl, and he sent an email, and I think he said at that point that the service tax projection was $861,000 additional dollars, give or take that number. I don't know exactly, but I thought that was an added benefit for us, and I thought that with all the retail businesses that's opened up that I know about, that sales tax would be a little bit more in the positive side than the negative. But, you know, I don't know what the numbers are.
Commissioner, one thing to think about is the businesses may have increased. We may have 20 more restaurants. But if people aren't spending their money, they would have more choices about where to spend it.
Yeah.
But the amount of money that they're spending may not have changed or may be more conservative. Now, if the economy turns around, having more businesses with more people spending money in different businesses would be helpful. But we also, like I said, this is the start of the process. I realize that most of the time when we have commissioner workshops, we're in May and June, and we have more data. So we will have more data between the next time you sit down again. But this is not the same type of budget workshop that we've had in the past. I do believe that the sales tax base will expand with services, but we just need some more data about how much it will expand. And what we're absolutely seeing is we're seeing losses. We are not where we would like to be for February sales tax, and we will see how they come in the next month or so.
Well, I think it's unrealistic to think that in 2 months we're going to see almost $2 million.
I'm just hoping people spent more money in January than but every month we'll have more data about the last month's expenditures. And we will have an increase based on the services that are being taxed, but how much that actually is, we will not know probably until we have had a full year of it.
Yeah.
I mean, when we're sitting down in 2017 and can look back and see how it's really hit Onslow County with expanding the base, is what's called expanding the base, paying the tax on services for which you know, the product's installed, you also provide sales tax on, then that's something, some more data that we'll have. But besides that, we also have something happening with restricted intergovernmental, mainly in Consolidated Human Services departments, and we're down $1.3 million, almost the same that we're looking at sales tax. We're down $1.3 million in restricted intergovernmental. And maybe Ms. Slater or Ms. Bauer would have some additional things to say about that later on during the day.
Okay. Is there any further questions for Jessica? We appreciate you and Harry coming and bringing the bad news to us.
Wish it was better news.
Ms. Roberts is here all day.
Yeah.
A lot of people.
Across the way.
Okay.
And if you give us just a second, commissioners, we'll set up.
Madam Chair.
Next presentation.
Chair, I need a potty break.
You don't need a break, ma'am. Need a break.
We're going to have a break.
Harry, thank you.
Thank you.
You'll be here all day as well.
Yes. That hand drank too much water.
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to step out for just a few minutes while you're getting set up.
Thank you, ma'am. Is that a break then?
Yes. This is one of the informal breaks.
Yes.
It's not going to work. You need a keyboard.
Hey, how you doing? Glad to have you. Doing all right today? All right. Well, I'm glad to see we've got a person that's going to be looking over our tourism money.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. How are you?
Where are you? Are you from here?
No, sir. I came from Albany, Georgia. I was working with the Convention Visitors Bureau down there. Yeah.